Be forgiven if you say we need to stop eating like this, because it was just a little bit more than 9 months ago we met here to celebrate the life of Fred Brooks and of Roy Bowl. And so we have come today to celebrate a reunion. And we do need to meet like this. We need to meet like this to support one another in our grief, but also to celebrate a life well lived. And so we're gathered together to witness to our faith, to remember the life which God gave to Florine Bowl. We come together in grief to acknowledge our loss, and we pray that God will grant us grace so that in pain we might find comfort, in sorrow, hope, in death, resurrection. The good news is that everything about us rejuvenates. When our bodies break, they will die, but when our spirits break, they rise again. Bow your heads with me. God, who gave us birth, you're ever more ready to hear than we are to pray, and you know our needs before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Give to us now your grace, that as we shrink before the mystery of death, we might see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and of death. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die. When our days here are accomplished, enable us to die as those who go forth to live, so that living or dying, our life may be in you, and nothing in life or in death will be able to separate us from your great love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Amen. You should know that Florine planned every aspect of the service. I think it's a sense of care, but also of being organized and valuing perfection. But it's good to know that she chose these words of comfort then, as we listen and reflect.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Precious Lord, lead me home. When my way grows drear, Precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand lest I fall, and take my hand, Precious Lord, lead me home.
God's word for comfort, for guidance. Often look to the 23rd Psalm at this time because the psalmist has been where we are, in the valley of the shadow. The psalmist says, Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Then the Apostle Paul writes to the people in Corinth in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, the first 10 verses. And Paul says, For we know that if the earthly tent that we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling, because when we are clothed, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Now the one who has fashioned us for this very purpose is God, who has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. Therefore, we are always confident, and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we live by faith and not by sight. We are confident, I say, and we would prefer to be away from the body and be at home with the Lord. And so we make it our goal to please Him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due us for the tidings done while in the body, whether good or bad. And in this text from the book of Revelation, in the 21st chapter, Then I saw, says John, a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you all for coming today to honor Florian's memory. The Bowles and Brooks clan think a lot of the fact that so many of you showed up today. It means a lot to us. We have some memories that I'd like to share with you today. These memories are from Florian's grandchildren, and we're going to start with Rob and our daughter Susan. It's entitled My Meemaw. When you look up the definition of a grandma, you will see a picture of my meemaw, or meme, as we shortened it as we got older. Meme is the epitome of what a grandmother is supposed to be. She spoiled me. She taught me lessons when I didn't even know she was teaching me. She taught me about family and what family means. I have so many memories of being with her. I am truly blessed. One of my first memories is when I would sit on her lap on the porch in the old farmhouse in her rocking chair. We would sit and rock together. I had to be only 4 or 5 years old at that time. Another fond memory is that she let me wear lipstick to school. And not just any lipstick, her bright red lipstick. Mame would paint my fingernails, let me dress up in her jewelry, and comb around the house in her high heels. Every Monday night when we were kids, Ryan and I would spend the night with Meme and Pa. Meemaw always made fried chicken, mashed potatoes, and homemade white gravy. I can still picture Meme and I at the stove together. I was stirring the gravy as she was adding the flour to the pan. Meme was such a good cook. Two of my favorites are her vegetable and beef soup and her chicken and dumplings. Every Sunday I would sit next to her in their pew at church. Meme always had some gum for me in her purse, and she was always at my sporting events and school concerts to support anything I did. A recent memory that I want to share, Elaine and I were visiting Meme on a Saturday. She was having a good day and was alert and awake, and she recognized us. Elaine had brought her some donuts that day, and she ate 1.5 donuts, which was a lot for her. We were talking to her, and she was trying so hard to talk back to us. We would try to guess what she was saying. She just wanted more donuts. She told both of us that she loved us, and we both said what a great mom and grandma she was. She hugged both of us as we left. And I knew I wanted that to be my final memory and goodbye to her. I will always remember her smile on that day and how a simple visit made her smile so much. Meme was ready to see Jesus and to be reunited with Pa. Those two can't be away from each other too long. I love you, Meme. You were the best grandma. I probably didn't tell you that enough, but I hope you knew it. And from Ryan. My Meme was very important to me, and I was to her also. She had a way of making me feel special with a quick smile, a warm hug, or the way she would listen when I talked, like there was nowhere she would rather be than right there with me. She was a hard worker and had a tremendous work ethic and could do it all. I've watched her work side by side out in the yard with my grandpa, and she would wear him out. She would cut the grass, pull lots of weeds, and rake lots of leaves, and had a way of making it fun and enjoyable with her stories while we worked. She made beautiful quilts and could make or modify just any piece of clothing. She was a trained beautician who could also shoot a chippy off the blue board box at 20 paces out of the kitchen while she was making dinner. I've seen it with my own eyes. Speaking of dinner, in my opinion, she was the best cook or baker around. I'm sure he means one of them. I could eat her fried chicken, mashed potatoes, and milk gravy every day of the week. She kept the most immaculately clean and organized house I've ever seen. Everything had a place, and if she couldn't find a place for it, she got rid of it. She couldn't stand clutter. She had a nervous energy about her that was very endearing. One of her most frequent sayings was, "Ryan, you're making me nervous." It could be about anything, but usually, if she thought I was going to break something or hurt myself the way boys do when they are young, by climbing too high in a tree or swimming out too far in a lake, I got a kick out of making her nervous and would do things to provoke a reaction. After I grew up, it was an inside joke between us. I would ask her, "Am I making you nervous, Mean?" We had a lot of good times together over many years, and I was blessed and very proud to have such a great woman for my Meemaw. The old saying, "They don't make them like they used to anymore," applies to her. And Elaine's children called Florine and Roy Mubby and Pop. So I'm going to read from their memories now. This is from Elaine's daughter, Rebecca. "I remember visiting Mubby and Pop during the summers of my childhood. Mubby was always in the farmhouse kitchen, fussing around, wiping down tables and countertops with something always boiling away on the stove. She canned the excess harvest from her large vegetable garden, and her sweet pickles were always the perfect companion to a simple bologna sandwich. There was a big industrial fan blowing in the corner of the kitchen, and after a hot afternoon of work on the farm, Pop would sit in front of the fan at the table with his shirt off to cool down. All the kids had cold cans of Pop. After dinner was finished and put away, the family would linger around the table, chatting or playing cards as the sun went down, and Mubby would always get out two heavy glass cookie jars and place them in the center of the table, one filled with chocolate chip cookies and the other with white butter cookies. The cookie jars had old metal lids that would frequently get stuck if they weren't put on correctly. Sometimes it took two or three people working together to get those darn lids off that one of us kids had put on crooked. Mubby's white butter cookies would literally melt in your mouth and were always absolutely delicious, despite her frequently grumbling away in the corner that it was a bad batch this time. We would eat cookie after cookie, with the cicadas whirring away in the background, mixing with the sound of the deck of cards being shuffled, getting ready for that next round of Uno." And this is from Elaine's son, Matt. "My grandma was always making sure her grandkids were taken care of. During one summer trip we made out to the farm in Cedar Hill, my older brother was given the privilege of driving the big tractor that Roy owned to cut pastures on the farm. Mubby saw me moping around and offered to let me use the small lawn tractor that she used to cut the small yard. I remember traveling around the yard in first gear, going really slow and seeing that I could speed up with the lever next to my leg. As soon as I did that, I could hear Mubby's high-pitched voice yelling to slow down and Roy running up to stop the tractor. I know she wanted to let me have some fun as long as it was safe, but so worried that this little city kid was going to get hurt. Mubby always made sure all the men in the family were well fed, too. One summer trip to Cedar Hill, I think I was about 5 years old, I remember getting up early ahead of my siblings and finding my way to the kitchen where Mubby had already served Pop a full bacon and egg breakfast and was making herself a cup of coffee. I told her I would like some toast and jelly folded over like Pop does. She had no trouble fixing two and then three pieces of toast. I was stuffed, but knew she enjoyed seeing me finish it." This memory is from Matt's wife, Krista. "Not everyone can say their future grandfather and grandmother-in-law almost made them cry when they first met. For anyone who doesn't know, Florine was a serious cutthroat Uno player, and as an easygoing teenager, I had no idea that Uno was not just a simple card game. I didn't even know that there were points in Uno till that day. We sat down for a fun family game of Uno, and I was on Florine's team. I was playing just like I'd always done with my family, keeping my wild draw four card till the end so I could go out easily. That's not how serious Uno should be played, though. Our team lost, and now my wild draw four cost us 50 points and we lost the game. Florine wanted to know why on earth I would hang on to the worst card. Well, now I know the risk of hanging onto that dreaded card, and I spent many years enjoying the cutthroat Uno world with her. She loved card games and took no prisoners, that's for sure. I'm very thankful for so many years laughing with her around the table, as well as we avoided being the victim who sat next to her in all her dirty cards." And this is from Brian. "On another one of those summer trips to Cedar Hill, I remember being allowed to drive the big Alice Chalmers tractor. How was I supposed to know as I was driving around the pasture that the cows had all left their cow pies everywhere. I couldn't have dodged them, even if I wanted to. So on the last trip back to the barn, I decided to kick the tractor into high gear. Well, upon my arrival to the barn, Mubby started doubling over with laughter. My entire back was covered in those wonderful soft cow pies flung there from the big tractor tires. She laughed until she cried and never let me live that down. I redeemed myself, though, as I grew into a teenager. She always said I was her favorite because I liked to save money, just like she did. She was proud that I inherited that gene from her. Brian also remembers Florine talking about dogs. All her life, she was deathly afraid of any dog over 10 pounds. Because as a kid, she walked home from school past a house that had a couple of big dogs that would run out to scare her every day. So one day, many years later, Florine was sitting in a friend's house at a party. There were about 20 people sitting in a big circle. The host had locked their dog in the basement, but for some reason, the dog escaped and came bounding up the stairs. Guess whose lap that 50-pound dog landed in? Yes, he landed right in Florine's lap, and she just about had a heart attack. So her fear of dogs continued. Florine's husband, Roy, was forever giving people nicknames. When he and Florine were dating, he must have been pretty close to her face one time. We heard that. And he noticed that she had soft peach fuzz on her face. He said, "You're fuzzy." So from that day on, Fuzzy stuck as her nickname. The family still uses Fuzzy and Aunt Fuzzy almost 80 years later. Roy also called Florine Boot. Before we were married, Florine told me, "You can call me Booty." And that's spelled B-O-O-D-I-E, in case you're thinking of anything else. There are no jokes about mother-in-laws for me, believe me. She was the best mother-in-law. She would say, "Would you let me bring this or that? Or would you let me do this? Would you allow me to do this?" And she never let me bring a dish for all those holiday meals she had at her house. She would always say, "Because I was working, I didn't have to bring a thing." After Susie was born, she gave us a date night every Monday night. She picked Susie up on her way home from her job at Merrimack Valley Insurance, then she dropped Susie off at Judy's on the way back to her job in the morning. So when Ryan got a little older, I assured Booty that he wanted to go also. She was a great cook. Chicken and dumplings have been mentioned, and thank goodness our neighbor Irene can make them just like me, so we can enjoy those still. Coconut cream pie, and every May for Roy and Rob's birthdays, German chocolate cake. As Ryan mentioned, there wasn't a cobweb around as long as Booty had her broom available. My worst fear, that she would go down in our basement. At Roy's funeral, I said Roy would be waiting for Florine at Heaven's Gate, ready to waltz her into heaven. And you know what? I'm sure he did.
Eva, we're going to enjoy a song for reflection.
I am weak,
but
you are. I'll be
a couple observations first. Thanks, Nancy, for all that you had to share. I just want everyone to know, when you're thinking about your eulogy and your favorite memories, that cow pies and card games will be included. We never seem to remember perfection. We seem to remember those things that have gone wrong, and that plus a little bit of time is what our memories are made of. I think that's special. The other thing I noted was that fried chicken and white gravy every Sunday means you can live to 97. That's one of the greatest signs of hope I could hear today. When I think about Florine, I think about a very proper lady who always looked impeccably put together. Now I know it's because she was the town cosmetologist. I think of a sharp wit. I remember the last Sunday when she and Ryan were in church here together that I can think of, and they were coming by the back door and greeting me, and I said, "You both look terrific today." And she elbowed Roy so hard he almost fell down, and she said, "He thinks we look terrific." She had a gentle spirit and a deep and abiding faith. I was thinking this morning, not too long before Nella Weber passed away, she stood in front of this historic cabinet out here in the church's vestibule, and she said, "You know what, that's my whole life in there," Melba said. And I noticed in these pictures that we shared during the visitation that the church was in the background of so many of those pictures, and that Flo and Roy could say the same thing, that this church was their whole life, and vice versa as well. In fact, I remember that in the cabinet out here, and the picture is still there, when the church celebrated its sesquicentennial in 2007, that they were celebrated as the longest married couple in the congregation. There are pictures in the cabinet out there. Our records show that she was baptized in June of 1924 in Wright City, and confirmed here at this altar, April the 14th, 1938. Her memory verse was from the book of Revelation, chapter 2, verse 10. "Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life." I was so tempted to hand everyone a crown today, but I only had just a handful of them. But the crown that we can anticipate as people of faith is a reward from God. And I kind of wanted to focus on that reward today. You know, the Apostle Paul says, when he writes to his favorite friends in Philippi, because they've sent him a cake with a file in it while he's in jail, he says, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." It's easy to preach about what might be gained in dying after a long and faithful life, but I want you to know, especially on this weekend when we're remembering the terrible tragedy of 20 years ago, I could preach this sermon after those funerals too, because people of faith have something to gain from death. God does not create us for this life only. And so what do we gain? We gain an incredible life. You know, in this body, we age. We need new knees. And we have pains and aches. I say to my wife every morning, "I don't know how you can lay down for 8 hours and wake up sore in the morning. What happened?" Revelation 21 says that God will wipe away every tear from our eyes. There won't be any more sorrow. There won't be any more pain. There won't be any more crying or brokenheartedness. Faithful people have to gain an incredible life when we die. When we die, we stand to gain eternal life. I bet you know John 3:16. You could say it with me. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son." The rest of it is that whoever believes in him will have everlasting life. And so it's good to know that we will live forever. Christ says we will never die. Life is a gift from God that changes. It's ever changing, but never ends. And also, Christians gain a glorious home. No matter how nice our home is here, even if it's well cleaned and well picked up. You know, I grew up in South St. Louis. The scrubby Dutch are deep in my... The joke in South St. Louis is that paramedics are here telling them I have to dust before they can come in. But we gain a perfect home. We gain a glorious home. John 14 says, "Let not your hearts be troubled. In my Father's house there are many rooms. God has prepared a home and a place." And finally, we gain perfection. We're not perfect in this life. Christ is the only one who came to show us what that looked like. But 1 John says in the 3rd chapter, "Beloved, we are children of God, and it's not yet been revealed what we shall be, but when we go to heaven, we will be like Christ." And we're called also to be like Christ in this life. And so we have suffered a loss today because we've lost someone and it hurts, but we can also thank God for what Flo has gained. And that would be all, but there's one more thing because of that reunion that she gained. And she passed away just one day after what would have been the 78th wedding anniversary. I remember they celebrated 77, sitting here in the pews. And I came across a story this week about a couple from Pottstown, Pennsylvania, who were given the distinction of being the longest married couple in their town after 77 years. Chester and Martha were their names. And they asked them what was the secret. And Chester said, "We've known each other since we were children. We probably should have been married when we were born." She said, "We've had a happy marriage because he usually says okay, and sometimes I say okay to him too." He said, "Five words have been the secret. Yes, dear, you were right." And I like to add to that, you know, you need to tell the husband he's right once in a while. You can find something, please. It'll make our day. Chester says, "I smile a lot." And that's why I thought to share that story today, because when we were planning together for today, Elaine said that the bowls always had a bowl of chocolate Hershey's out, the mini bars. By the way, mentioning the bowls, I should have said, and I meant to, before I accepted the call to this church now nearly 16 years ago, I looked at the church directory and there were like 5 pages of bowls in there. And I thought, I better not mess with these people. But there were always chocolates out, always chocolate mini bars out. And I thought to look back at some of the old Hershey's commercials, and their old slogan used to be, "There's a smile in every bar." There's a smile in every bar. So Elaine and Rob wanted everyone to have a smile today. And may it be that thinking about the good and faithful life of our friend Florine then will always put a smile on our face. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We're going to be dismissed now, and if you want to go to the graveside, we can go out this way. I'll hold the door open, and we can meet at the graveside. And we'll go now in peace.
Come right, and when this life is over.